Hello, I'm Montse Alvarado, and this is EWTN News In Depth.
Pope Francis starts a new tradition as the church celebrates the first World Day for grandparents and the elderly.
I think that grandparents are the heart and soul of the family. They are there. They are the patriarchs. They are the role models.
A woman who was a driving force behind this special day shares her joy at the official recognition for seniors.
Increasingly, as the elderly population is growing and growing by leaps and bounds, it's going to become more of a crisis.
The serious challenges the Little Sisters of the Poor face in caring for aging communities, what's needed to make sure seniors receive proper support. And EWTN is there post-COVID as the Holy Land slowly reopens to visitors. EWTN News In Depth is next.
Dear grandfathers and grandmothers, dear elderly friends, I am with you always are also the words that I, as Bishop of Rome and an elderly person like yourselves, would like to address to you on this first World Day of Grandparents and the Elderly.
Pope Francis's message of solidarity and compassion in his announcement of the first World Day for Grandparents and the Elderly, the theme, I am with you always. Welcome to EWTN News In Depth. This weekend, the Catholic Church will honor our seniors with a new day dedicated to them. The fourth Sunday of July coincides with the feast day of St. Joachim and St. Anne. They're the parents of our Blessed Mother and the earthly grandparents of Jesus. We can embrace them as our spiritual grandparents. While the New Testament has no specific information about their lives, there are apocryphal writings about them. The Church honors Saints Joachim and Anne for their role in the salvation of the world. Pope Francis notes the role grandparents and the elderly play for the salvation of souls today, with their prayers and works in their communities. This day of recognition comes after years of one organization's work in promoting it. Mark Irons shares the story of one of the advocates and some of the Catholic grandparents there today.
It's a great joy to see grandchildren willing to take time out of their busy schedules to come talk to us, spend time with us, share their life with us.
Bob and Beverly Ward say nothing compares to being grandparents.
I look at the grandchildren that we have now and how special each one is to me.
Beverly, 79, and Bob, 80, are among the elderly around the world to be celebrated by the Catholic Church this Sunday. The World Day for Grandparents and the Elderly has become a reality thanks to the Catholic Grandparents Association.
I am truly overjoyed, and I think that it's like a bit like mission accomplished, and I can die happy.
Since 2012, Catherine Wiley, the founder of the organization, has been advocating for a day of recognition for grandparents and the elderly, just as the younger celebrated.
As well as having a World Youth Day, that we needed, desperately needed, a World Day for grandparents.
The Catholic Grandparents Association logo shows Saints Joachim and Anne, the grandparents of Jesus.
Everything we know about these holy grandparents comes to us through tradition or apocryphal writings. And again, what is consistent in all the stories is they were a holy, pious couple.
Dan Miola works in mission ministry at the St. John Paul II National Shrine in Washington, D.C. The shrine is preparing for its own celebration of grandparents and the elderly this weekend. Miola says through prayer, Catholics can build a relationship with Saints Joachim and Anne.
They were devoted to acts of charity as well. And I think this day in particular, Pope Francis is calling us to live out those acts of charity towards the elderly, towards our grandparents.
Pope Francis once said, "The elderly who have the faith are like trees that continue to bear fruit." Faith has strengthened the marriage of Bob and Beverly Ward.
I think that that's been the whole thing that has really united us always.
And the Wards share what they've learned with their six grandkids.
To trust God in His divine plan. It's far better than what you can figure out.
Catherine Wiley says the elderly are tasked with passing on the Catholic faith to younger generations.
When the grandchildren come to stay with me, we say grace before meals. They all know it off by heart. We say night prayers, and they're the same prayers.
Dan Miola told us he comes from a broken family, and his grandparents were the main role models for love and later his marriage.
Without a doubt, I am the person I am today because of my grandparents. They were that important in being a mentor to me about the faith, about love, and about marriage. They gave me hope.
And now the elderly will be recognized by the Global Catholic Church annually from here on out.
Every year, grandparents will be honored and thanked and acknowledged for everything they do for the church and for the family and bring together families and grandchildren.
Mark Irons, EWTN News In Depth.
The first request for a World Day for Grandparents was made at the Eucharistic Congress in Dublin in 2012. In 2017, the Catholic Grandparents Association made a formal appeal to Pope Francis. And 4 years later, the prayer requests were answered with the announcement of a new church-wide celebration. Pope Francis is granting plenary indulgences for those who participate in the first World Day of Grandparents and the Elderly, which is July 25th. The indulgence will be granted under sacramental confession, Eucharistic communion and prayer, and according to the intentions of the Pope while he presides over Mass. It's also granted for those who devote time visiting the elderly or those who are sick or disabled. The Church teaches all life is precious, from conception until natural death, a teaching that contradicts the current throwaway culture that has permeated our society. Numerous Catholic organizations and apostolates embrace our aging communities, including the Little Sisters of the Poor. Sister Constance Veit, the communications director of the Little Sisters of the Poor, is on the record to explain that help and what's needed to keep care for our seniors. What does this mean to you? It's very personal to you, I believe.
Yes, it is very personal to me because by my vocation as the Little Sister of the Poor, I've given my life to the church and to the elderly, specifically to the elderly, because that's our sole apostolate. So to see the elderly being honored and recognized in this way is a very deep joy for me. And it's something I've noticed about Pope Francis's pontificate from the beginning, how often he speaks about the elderly and how often he encourages young people to connect with their elders. The first time I really noticed it was at a World Youth Day. So to think that at a World Youth Day, you know, a day dedicated to an event dedicated to youth, he encouraged them to be united with their grandparents and with the elderly. So that really touched me. And then when Pope Francis came to the United States in 2015 and we had the opportunity to meet him, that's what I said to him. You know, I rehearsed all day what I was going to say to him. And what I said to him was to thank him for the attention that he's bringing to the elderly.
So then how does your ministry, let's take a step back and talk about the Little Sisters of the Poor. How do
Sure.
you answer that call in Matthew 28:20, I'm with you always, that Pope Francis is always talking about?
Right. Well, you know, for us as Little Sisters, that's what our life is all about, what our mission is all about, to assure the elderly that they'll never be alone, they'll never be abandoned. And so, first of all, we say to them, each of us says to them, I will always be with you. But then we hope that our presence will be a reminder to them that God is always with them. You know, it doesn't stop with us, but our whole hope and our whole effort is to bring the presence of Christ to them.
And so your order does what kind of care of the elderly?
So we're an international congregation, and all over the world we have homes for the elderly where we welcome them into our home, and they become family to us. So, you know, to create a home, a true home with them. So we don't do, for instance, we don't do in-home nursing, going out to people's home like visiting nurses, and we don't you know, work out on the street with people. It's all about bringing people into our houses, which are true homes, and incorporating them into our family.
And how do you provide for them?
Good question. So we provide for them. It varies around the world because, as like in the United States, we do receive Medicaid funds because we are only for the low-income elderly. So here in the States, they do, many of them do, they're eligible for Medicaid. But even what we receive from Medicaid and other forms of income like pensions they might have usually only covers about half of our expenses. And so for the rest, we have a tradition since the beginning of the congregation of going out into the community and begging for alms. We call it the begging or the collecting, where we ask people in our local communities to support us. Today, this is done in many ways, by mail campaigns, by online giving, but we still have sisters who go out on a regular basis, out into the community, to markets, to businesses, to ask for gifts in kind. And so that's really what sustains us. And, you know, it's all the time. It's not like one capital campaign and then it's over. It's like to keep our mission going, we keep it going. We sustain it with donations.
Let's talk a little bit about what Pope Francis is asking the elderly to do. He said that the Great Commission doesn't stop when you become old, right? So what is this call to the elderly to join in the Great Commission? What are they supposed to do?
Okay, he talks all the time. He has three key words with the elderly: dream, memory, and prayer. So the first one, dream, it's the hardest one for me to explain. It comes from the prophet Joel. Young men shall dream. Young men shall see visions, and old men shall dream dreams. And I think what he means by that is that the elderly still have a vision or a dream about what they wish for life, for society, for the world, and for them to share that with young people, to inspire young people. Then memory is to remember. He talks about that, interestingly, with some of the tragic things of the past, mm-hmm. like the Second World War.
Passing on these stories.
Yes, passing on these stories, and often they might involve hardship or struggle, to give a context to young people, you know, for their dreams. Because one of the problems with our current culture, with the dominant culture, is that there's no memory. It's as if we were born today, not even yesterday, but today. But to give them a memory to help them appreciate where we come from, how we got to where we are, the impact of events. And, you know, that old saying, history repeats itself, you know? So to help them have a sense of history and memory. And then the third thing is prayer, certainly to the prayer of intercession, to try to intercede for the needs of the world. And that is really beautiful, because even an elderly person who's living alone, who might be housebound, who might be isolated, they might not have direct contact with younger people, but they can always offer their prayers for the needs of the world. And that's what we tell our residents, particularly those who are very infirm, they still have the opportunity to offer their sufferings and their sacrifices for the needs of the world.
And so you very much take on that call that there's no retirement age in the work of the Great Commission. So then let's talk a little bit about the struggles that you've encountered and the challenges that you see in doing your work and caring for the elderly. What are the major challenges?
Well, I think that there are certain challenges specific to the pandemic time, and then the ongoing challenge, just I would say pre-pandemic and let's hope post-pandemic, that it comes to an end. There is a certain amount of ageism in society. I think we're actually experiencing more and more a difficulty finding staff, enough staff and trained staff to care for the elderly. And there are real shortages in the workforce with geriatric trained physicians, social workers, psychologists, nurses, all the way down to the level of nursing assistants, who are the real ones who do the bulk of the hands-on care in our homes. And so, you know, it's a complex thing, but in our society, I think caregivers are not, they're not recompensed enough. There aren't incentives to go into geriatrics, and that starts from physicians all the way down. You know, there are exciting specialties that are very lucrative, but geriatrics is not one of them. So I think there's not enough money allocated in our, you know, federal budgets, for instance, it's not encouraged enough for people to choose elder care as a profession. And so, you know, increasingly, as the elderly population is growing and growing by leaps and bounds, it's going to become more of a crisis, the lack of care of trained caregivers. I would say that's our biggest challenge, because God always seems to provide for us financially, and Yeah, the money, although it's a constant ongoing challenge, he always seems to come through, but more and more the challenge is in the area of caregivers.
And people, letting people or inspiring people so that God can move their hearts to want to give their life to the elderly the way that you have.
Yes, caregivers and vocations, I should say.
100%.
Is the other big challenge for us, yeah. They go hand in hand.
So then how does this day give you hope? What does this mean to you and your community?
Well, for me, I'm using it as an opportunity to raise people's awareness of the gifts that the elderly can offer. Also our duty, you know, God, in the Ten Commandments, we're asked to honor our mother and father. And I was actually reading recently that actually was not written for little kids to obey their parents, but it really in scripture refers more to the duty to care for one's parents throughout life, especially their elderly parents. So I would hope that this day raises awareness of the duty that we have. Pope Francis, in something that he wrote or one of his talks, he talked about accepting the elderly as a gift and reinvigorating a sense of hospitality and acceptance toward them. So I'm hoping that this day will contribute to that.
Thank you so much, Sister Constance.
You're welcome.
Sister Constance also shared her unique artwork reflecting the World Day for Grandparents and the Elderly. You can find out more about this on our social media channels, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, where we will share more exclusive content. We continue our hour-long coverage about grandparents and the elderly. Next, important Catholic voices join us to talk more about making sure our seniors are cherished and well cared for as they age. Then later, fighting back against the myths and fallacies of ageism, an expert panel weighs in.
And mysteries of the faith. We will travel to the most holy place in all of Christianity, the birthplace of Jesus Christ. An EWTN pilgrimage is coming up.
The future of the world depends on this covenant between young and old. Who, if not the young, can take the dreams of the elderly and make them come true?
Pope Francis expresses the importance of a generational commitment to one another during his announcement of the first World Day for Grandparents and the Elderly. Welcome back to EWTN News in Depth. I'm Montse Alvarado. As we explore what this special day means for our senior community, we want to recognize the importance of advocating for the elderly and committing to protecting our aging communities. To expand on this topic, we're joined now by Catherine Lopez, Senior Fellow at the National Review Institute, and Dr. Charles Camosi, author and Associate Professor at Fordham University. Thank you so much for joining us. Catherine, you have an important role with Cardinal Dolan's Pro-Life Commission in New York. How is advocating for the elderly part of Catholic teaching and pro-life values?
Well, the Archdiocese of New York has palliative care services, and part of their arch care program is making sure that the elderly are taken care of. But we really saw a crisis in New York State when COVID hit, and Charlie was a huge part of being a prophetic voice in that, making sure that the most vulnerable, especially our elderly in nursing homes, were treated equally. Pope Francis has talked from the beginning of his pontificate about a throwaway culture. And when we saw a lens on how we treat our elderly during COVID. And there were, you know, wonderful people in nursing homes trying to do their best in emergency conditions. But why are we warehousing elderly is a question I think we need to ask ourselves, and that Pope Francis is inviting us to with this day. And I think, you know, every family has to address these issues in different ways based on, you know, where they are geographically and all the rest. But we need to value our old as we, you know, celebrate our young so often. We have so much wisdom to learn from our elderly, and just because they're not as productive as they used to be doesn't mean that they're of less value.
And sometimes they can be even more productive. Dr. Kamosi, just like Catherine mentioned, in 2019, you wrote about resisting the throwaway culture. And now you've written a new book called Losing Our Dignity, How Secularized Medicine is Undermining Fundamental Human Equality. How does this secular understanding of the human person affect the elderly?
Well, I think it affects them in two ways. First, the ways that Catherine just mentioned, a kind of throwaway society. If you're not productive, if you're not autonomous, if you're not like the rest of us with regard to those things, you just get discarded in a warehouse of death. But in that book, I think I take it up a notch and say, you know, about half the people in nursing homes have some kind of dementia. And once dementia reaches the point where you lack even kind of rationality and self-awareness, there's another level you hit in the throwaway culture where they say you don't even count as a person like the rest of us. We've seen this with abortion, with prenatal children. We've seen this with persistent vegetative state and so-called brain death. I write about both of those in the book. We see it with Charlie Gard and Alfie Evans, the catastrophic brain injuries they had and how they were also just basically not considered the equal of other kinds of toddlers.
This redefinition of personhood is definitely something that we have to be wary about. Catherine, you touched on this a little bit. The history of hospitals and aid for the poor and the vulnerable in the United States doesn't exist without the story of the Catholic Church's engagement. Can you explain why?
Right. I mean, when you think about the history of the Catholic Church in the United States, there were so many sisters who were trailblazers for helping the orphans and the widows, right? And in our new reality in the church, where there are a lot more lay people in leadership, we really need to be asking questions. And Charlie and I have these conversations frequently about if there are abandoned convents and other buildings that our church property, could lay people come together and you know, buy the property and have a small home where we take care of our elderly. Because in every community, you know, we do have elderly people who are living on their own. My heart was broken when I was talking to a pastor in New York City recently, and he was talking about the violence that we've had in Washington Square Park. And there are elderly people who are parishioners who live in some of the buildings around Washington Square Park, and they're terrified. Well, as Catholic people, why are we not embracing these people and thinking of creative ways to be family to them? Because they are family. You know, if their family isn't around, these are the questions I think we need to be asking, and that Pope Francis is inviting us to ask. And he had an apostolic exhortation a couple of years ago where he talked about our universal call to holiness, and he talked about the fact that, you know, all our saints aren't going to be headliners. Our saints are frequently our mothers and grandmothers and fathers and these silent and grandfathers, these sort of hidden witnesses of sanctity. And we need to be more aware of that.
Those who are doing the work of family. Charles, understanding this context that Catherine just gave us, what are the greatest threats to the elderly today?
Well, I think the primary threat is full secularization, where we move away from this concept of human equality, which comes from being made in the image and likeness of God, sharing a nature, in fact, which reflects the image and likeness of our Creator, to something like production. Have you ever heard this phrase, being a productive member of society? It makes me want to throw up, right? That's not where our dignity comes from. That's certainly not where our human equality comes from. Those things come from us sharing a common nature. And then on top of it, if you add Matthew 25 to it, we have to look around for those who are on the margins, for those who don't fit with the secularized understanding of who matters and who is valuable. Once you've said that there are things called human non-persons, like prenatal children and brain dead individuals and those in a persistent vegetative state, the next shoe to drop are human beings who are fundamentally disabled and don't have these things anymore. So that's where I see the most potent threat coming from.
Catherine, do you think this productivity issue is something that has driven Pope Francis, not from a physical productivity, but a lack of spiritual productivity on our part?
Oh, my goodness. Yeah. I mean, that's why we are where we are. You know, I'm so concerned about this return to normal. You know, there's a lot of stuff about normal that wasn't healthy. It was not spiritually healthy. And part of this is we cannot be ignoring our elderly. We cannot be casting aside those who aren't as productive. You know, productivity is not what we're going to be judged by. And we really, you know, in America in a particular way, I think we have a real struggle, a real temptation here. You know, it's not, you know, I'm in the public square. It's not my byline that I'm going to be judged by. It's the love that I show for my neighbor. And that includes, you know, the slow person walking on the street, you know. We really, really have to be looking at each other as Christ, you know. And Pope Francis knows we're not doing that.
So then, Charlie, how do you see the role of the Catholic Church in being the leader in changing the narrative here?
Well, in multiple ways. And I spend the final chapter of the book, or the conclusion of the book, kind of talking about this. But the primary way, I think, is to not be embarrassed to say human equality comes from being made in the image and likeness of God. And frankly, we have lots of allies on this, not only fellow Christians, but fellow Jews and Muslims who in some ways are leading the charge on this in many ways. I live in New Jersey. It was Orthodox Jews in New Jersey that carved out a religious exemption so that they could take care of their brain dead loved ones and not have them essentially dehydrated and starved to death. So first, we just need to proclaim this very clearly and carefully and forthrightly and with charity. But then I think we need to go further than that. I think we do need to organize along some of the ways that Catherine was saying. We have empty buildings, schools, convents, rectories sitting around. Those should not just sit around empty. We should be using those. And then I think we also need to help cultivate families and empower families. One of the main reasons why there are so many elderly warehoused until they die is because families either choose not to take care of them, or they just simply don't have the resources. There aren't children around to take care of them. I'm guilty.
Charlie, I look forward to finishing your book.
Take care of them.
I know that everyone else looks forward to purchasing it as well. And Catherine, thank you so much for being with us. EWTN's website has a host of information on our senior community. Head to the search bar and type in Dignity of Older People to read about the church's relationship with the elderly, pastoral care for seniors, and find biblical references related to this content. We'll have a grandparent tribute a little later in this show with photo submissions from you, our viewers. But next, top headlines in the Week in Review.
Scenes of devastation in Germany as residents dig out after record floods. Now major questions about a failed warning system and whether lives could have been saved. And as the Delta variant surges, one group urges COVID vaccinations while the other side takes to the streets to protest so-called COVID health passes. EWTN News In Depth is back after this break.
Topping the Week in Review, in the biggest decline since World War II, life expectancy in the U.S. dropped by 1.5% last year. That's an 18-month drop, according to the Centers for Disease Control, which says the coronavirus is largely to blame. Americans are now expected to live an average of 77.3 years, down from 78.8 years in 2019. The report indicates that 75% of the decline can be attributed to deaths from the pandemic. 11% of the decline stems from accidents or unintentional injuries, including drug overdose deaths. The Delta variant of COVID-19 is leading to a rise in cases and hospitalizations across the globe. The Centers for Disease Control says that it spreads more easily than other versions.
CDC has released estimates of variants across the country and predicted the Delta variant now represents 83% of sequenced cases. This is a dramatic increase from 50% the week of July 3rd.
Two-thirds of adults in the U.S. have received their first dose of the vaccine. However, vaccination rates have slowed. The pandemic is also having a significant impact on the Olympic Games in Japan, which officially opened on Friday. All spectators are banned as Japan enforces a state of emergency. COVID cases are spiking there, and despite near-empty venues, officials remain worried about a super spreader event. Tokyo's Catholic Archbishop has asked visiting athletes and coaches to refrain from attending Catholic Mass in local churches. The Archdiocese had originally planned to welcome international visitors, but has now canceled all pastoral programs. In France, more than 100,000 people took to the streets in cities across the country to protest government-mandated vaccine passports. Police went into effect this week, making it mandatory to show proof of vaccination in order to access restaurants, trains, and other public venues. Demonstrators say the government is overstepping and are wary of the safety of the vaccine. Despite the protests, France has seen a surge in vaccinations. Drug maker Johnson & Johnson and three big U.S. drug distribution companies are on the verge of a multi-billion dollar deal to settle a national lawsuit over the toll of the opioid addiction crisis. A coalition of local governments sued the companies. The $26 billion settlement is the biggest so far in a complicated web of litigation. There will now be a months-long process for state and local governments to decide if they will sign on. The money is intended to go towards community treatment, recovery, and prevention efforts.
I know so many other moms that are in this situation where they actually lost a child or lost a loved one. And so, you know, no amount of money can make up for that. But hopefully it'll be enough where people can start getting better access to treatment and things like that at the local level where, you know, entire cities and counties have just been decimated in some cases.
Several other lawsuits, many filed by individual states, are expected to begin in coming months. The opioid pandemic, including the use of both prescription painkillers and illegal drugs like heroin and fentanyl, has been linked to more than 500,000 deaths in the U.S. since the year 2000. Parts of Europe have been slammed with severe and deadly flooding after torrential rain last week. Austria, Hungary, Switzerland, and Belgium were all hit hard. More than 30 people died in Belgium. Another 70 are still unaccounted for. In Germany, more than 190 people have died and 700 injured after devastating floods. Roads and homes have been washed away. Miles of muddy debris now litter towns. Rescuers are still searching for hundreds who were unaccounted for, their efforts hampered by the sheer scale of the damage to infrastructure. Multiple bridges are destroyed, phone and power lines are down, and at least 80 train stations are closed. Questions are now being raised about the warning systems in Germany and politicians facing scrutiny over serious failings in Germany's flood preparedness. The U.S. and Western allies have formally blamed the Chinese government for a massive computer hack that affected governments, universities, and small businesses around the globe. The attack on Microsoft email servers happened earlier this year. The U.S. Justice Department says the Chinese are using criminal contract hackers to steal confidential business information and intellectual property. This is the first time NATO allies have called out China for its aggressive cyber espionage.
Sono anche vicino al caro popolo cubano in questi momenti.
Pope Francis addressed the civil unrest in Cuba at his first appearance at the Vatican window since returning from surgery. The Holy Father said he hoped the country will become more just and fraternal. Nationwide protests rocked communist-run Cuba a week ago. Francis urged Cubans to entrust their protection to the Blessed Mother, who he says will accompany them on their journey. The General Secretary to the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, Monsignor Jeffrey Burrill, has resigned amid sexual misconduct allegations, including reports alleging that he made use of a popular hookup app on his mobile device. A statement from the USCCB's president, Archbishop Gomez, said the information it received did not include allegations of misconduct with minors, but did not elaborate further on the allegations. Burrill was elected General Secretary of the USCCB in November of 2020 and has held positions at the North American College in Rome and served as a pastor in Wisconsin. Much more still to come here on EWTN News in Depth.
I never in my life seen like this. We are feeling that it's the end of our life.
And later, the aftermath of COVID in Israel. Empty shops and empty streets very slowly coming back to life as pilgrims start to return. But first, being vibrant into our golden years. Our next guest says old is cool. Plus seniors giving back through Catholic Charities Foster Grandparents Program. EWTN News in Depth will be right back. Our elderly are vital in passing on our faith and are often an underused resource. Creating inclusive environments for seniors is paramount to our society's health. here to talk about their work in shifting the narrative of how we view our aging community's ability to contribute to society are Lizzie Perales, Vice President of Programs at Catholic Charities for the Diocese of San Antonio, Texas, and Charles Deville Morin, the CEO and co-founder of Linked Senior. Lizzie, your work with seniors includes a program that connects them to children called the Foster Grandparent Program. How does that work?
Hi, yes, thank you so much for having us. So the Foster Grandparent Program is a nationally recognized program that allows seniors who are 55 and older to be, of course, vetted and placed in whether that's schools, hospitals, daycares, areas where there's children in high need for mentoring and tutoring. And our grandparents serve on a daily basis to provide social and emotional support to these children to ensure that they have positive outcomes, both academically and as well in their life. And of course, it is a huge benefit to our seniors, reducing their isolation and instilling all the wisdom that they have to share back into the younger generation.
And why is this such an important opportunity for the aging community in San Antonio?
This opportunity is extremely important because, of course, as you know, many of our seniors are isolated or may not have opportunities to be out and engage with the greater community. And so this opportunity gives them an incentive and a reason to go out and to serve and to take all the wisdom and all of the life lessons that they have had in their lifetime and share that back with our younger generation. And as you know, this isn't only good for the senior, it's also good for the child, because as you know, one of the most important factors for children is to have someone caring in their life that's helping be a positive role model. And so even if a child has one of those people, which could be a foster grandparent, that will help them have an overall better outcome and quality of life.
Charles, you're doing something very similar, but in the for-profit world, to create opportunities for seniors. What does Linked Senior do?
Hello, thank you for having me. Linked Senior is a company. We provide a senior living resident engagement platform. So we help assisted living, memory care, nursing homes engage their elders, their residents, regardless of their preferences and where they are physically or cognitively. So we help them stay socially engaged. We empower the staff to increase their satisfaction, and we increase
And what are some of the positive effects of these programs? Tell us a little bit more.
Well, a lot of our work is helping measure the impact on quality of life. So we correlate these outcomes with what's called clinical outcomes that are really measurable and that lead financial outcomes. And through the pandemic, something that we've kind of partnered with our clients to do is really fighting social isolation. That existed before the pandemic. We know that social isolation is a greater risk to healthy aging than obesity. And there was an AARP study that shows that it's as bad as smoking 7 cigarettes a day.
Wow.
But we've seen just the impact of social isolation on both the elder and the staff. And it's been amazing to see the heroes working there every day.
Lizzie, Charles's work addresses something we've all seen, burnout in the long-term care industry. But burnout also occurs in other programs. How does the Foster Grandparent Program help with burnout for your Catholic Charities staff?
That's a great question. Thank you so much for asking. So, of course, as you know, in the social service field, there is so much need and so much that we can only do as an organization or as a nonprofit. So by leveraging our seniors and by following our Catholic social teaching of dignity of the whole person and aging with grace, we're able to utilize these volunteers to do some of our critical work and our mission of selfless service to the community. So we truly could not do it without these grandparents. There are so many children in our community in need of a positive mentor or role model, and we could not do it without our 86 foster grandparents.
Charles, your slogan, "Old people are cool." What led you to this work and why?
So we have this, thank you for asking. We have this campaign called "Old People Are Cool," and I'm showing now a sticker that we've been giving out. Well, that started really because I was lucky to be raised in a family that really valued, family values. And I was lucky. I just saw something very similar about 6 years ago, and we decided to take a stand as a company and as a way to give back. And, you know, there's really a number of reasons, but two really important to us, which is one, you know, everybody is cool. Dr. Seuss says a person is a person no matter how small. And we believe that a person is a person no matter how old. And I think it's important to recognize that every human being has a right for the pursuit of purpose, right? And with that, it's important to dignify them. So this platform that I just mentioned, and again, there is a website called oldpeoplear.cool, and it's just a nice way to engage a conversation around anti-ageism. I'd like to just mention one thing which is important is when we started this campaign, people told us that we should try to avoid the word old. Mm. And that is exactly what we're trying to do, is tackle the fact that as a society, we've built in a deficiency in the word old. And we want to reclaim that word as a valuable word, as a valuable members of our society, and actually honor them and dignify them.
Right. Rather than creating an off-ramp, you're engaging people again. Let's talk, absolutely, as our last little question here, let's talk about cultural differences. You mentioned you come from a family that valued family. You come from France. Charles, what's the difference in what you've seen with France and the U.S. here?
Well, in France, I think there are deeper family social connectedness in the sense that families are less spread out. And we spend probably a little bit more time together. These are principal values, differences that I've seen, yeah.
Lizzie, what about you in San Antonio? I'm sure that you have a big immigrant influence. Is that something that affects your work as well?
Yeah, so I think one of the amazing things in San Antonio, I actually grew up on the Northeast in New Jersey, but San Antonio, I see a lot of multi-generational families. So it's so wonderful to see when a family's able to actually have a grandparent, or extended family members living in the same household with them. But unfortunately, as we know, not everybody has that reality. We have a lot of seniors that maybe don't have anyone in their family living close or even someone to care for them. And so that's where we come in as a non-for-profit in some of these programs to identify those seniors and bring them out of isolation.
Well, we appreciate your work, both of you, in the for-profit and the nonprofit sector to engage seniors. Thank you.
Thank you.
Up next on EWTN News In Depth, one of the pleasures of retirement for many is the opportunity to finally do some long-anticipated travel. Well, you can stay right where you are as we do the legwork for you. We're whisking you away on a beautiful trip right after the break. During the pandemic, most international trips were canceled as countries closed their borders. That includes a destination many people wait their entire lives to visit, Israel, the birthplace of Jesus Christ. But right now, thanks to reporter Colin Flynn, we're going to take you on a pilgrimage to the Holy Land. And you don't even need to leave your easy chair. Here's this week's Faith Journey in Depth.
The land where I'm standing now is one of the most holy and sacred and important lands in the world to Muslims, to Jews and Christians. But like everywhere else, when COVID hit, the country was forced to shut down. And for the over 3 million tourists and pilgrims who had come here annually, they were not allowed in. Well, after almost a year and a half, the Holy Land is slowly starting to reopen.
Although tourists are still not permitted to enter Israel, small pilgrim groups with the correct authorization are allowed entry on a trial basis. This pilgrimage was organized by a section of the Vatican called Romana Pellegrinaggi and had 19 people on the trip, including Cardinal Enrico Froci. They are one of the first pilgrimage groups to come back to the Holy Land and experience it in a very special way. right next to a wall known as the Israeli West Bank Barrier, a contentious border in the Israeli-Palestinian dispute, is Bethlehem, and the tour group's first stop as they pay a visit to the Basilica of the Nativity. Outside, there is a priest from Mexico who is based here and is surprised to see the pilgrimage group.
I came just to visit the church. When I see the group, oh, for me it's a very big surprise. It's a happiness, a big happiness. A very difficult time for us. Pray to God that people come to return to the Holy Land.
The Basilica is the oldest and one of the best preserved churches in the Holy Land, and the group get a chance to take in the incredible mosaics on the walls, which are from the time of the Crusades, telling the story of Jesus.
The mosaics have been renovated 2 years ago and were made later in the Middle Ages, but are very, very beautiful. And if you see the mosaics, you see angels, a movement of angels who go
towards
the grotto.
Under the altar is the grotto, and surrounded by lanterns and icons is the spot which they believe is the very spot where Jesus was born in a manger 2,000 years ago. The group prays here and takes in what's in front of them. Incredibly, they are here almost on their own, with just a handful of other pilgrims. Back outside the Basilica, in the square of Bethlehem, there is a small souvenir shop that sells handmade wood carvings. Ronnie runs this shop, which has been in his family for over 100 years.
My grandfather, Epifanio, he established this store in 1927. And then Victor, my father, the second generation, he's almost 56 years here. And then me and my brother, Epifanio, the third generation. And then my son, I hope he will be the fourth generation. His name is Victor.
The family store has seen many hard times in the past, but Ronnie says nothing compares to this.
To see the Nativity Church without any pilgrim, this is something like a dream. We are dreaming, and we are sometimes afraid. When my father, Victor, tell me, Ronnie, I never in my life seen like this. We are feeling that it's the end of our life, because 80% of the population in Bethlehem, they are depending on tourism.
Almost 70% of Israel's population is now fully vaccinated. In fact, Israel was hailed as a world leader in the early vaccine rollout after striking a deal with Pfizer. As a result, the number of COVID cases, hospitalizations, and deaths has been quite low for some time. However, the country is now experiencing a spike in cases, reaching over 1,200 positive cases a day due to the Delta variant. Previously, older generations were more at risk, but this time around, the burden has shifted to younger, unvaccinated Israelis. Tourists are still not permitted to visit. Only small, fully vaccinated pilgrimage groups. Next on the pilgrimage tour is Nazareth, a few hours' drive north of Jerusalem, the city which is believed to be where Mary was from and which would become the childhood home of Jesus, earning him the name Jesus of Nazareth. The Basilica of the Annunciation has been built around a small cave, which is where tradition says that the angel Gabriel appeared to Mary and announced that she would conceive and bear a child who would be the Son of God. Normally closed to the public, the group were able to enter the cave, getting to touch the stone. A museum next door has artifacts excavated from the area. One is the base of a column, which has been dated to the first century after the death of Christ. Incredibly, there is a graffiti carving on it from that time in Greek, which translated says, "Hail Mary," strong evidence that there was a devotion to Mary in the early church, right from the beginning. And finally, one of the last stops on the tour. Located in the heart of the Christian quarter in the Old City of Jerusalem is the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. Dating back to the 4th century, inside are two of the holiest sites in Christianity, the site where they believe Jesus was crucified and Jesus' empty tomb, where he was laid to rest and from where he rose from the dead. It brings to an end what has been a very moving pilgrimage for this small group. To be standing here right outside the Church of the Holy Sepulchre and for it to be absolutely quiet is really remarkable. And for the small groups of pilgrims who've been able to experience the Holy Land like this, it really has been a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Now, the Israeli government say that they hope to reopen their borders to pilgrims and tourists this autumn, but with a recent increase in positive cases in the country, they might have to rethink that strategy. In Jerusalem, Colm Flynn, EWTN News In Depth.
Another beautiful piece from Colm. Since we can't go there right now, he's brought it to us. Thank you. And as we close, one of our favorite parts of our program today. Last week, we asked you to submit photos of important family moments as we honor grandparents and the elderly this weekend. We heard from a lot of you, and we're now so happy to share viewer submissions in these images of the week. Everyone knows grandma equals cookies. Thanks to Mary from Vincennes, Indiana for this photo submission. And let's not forget Grandpa Mark doing some high-level engineering over there in the corner. Marianne and Christo from Johannesburg, South Africa are very busy when this active crew of 8 grandchildren come visiting. Beverly of Ponchatoula, Louisiana loves taking her 2 youngest grandchildren to story time at the library, doing fun activities and then slipping in a little nap for everyone after lunch. Here's Regina from Drexel Hill, Pennsylvania, and her granddaughter Ella Marie during a super fun trip to sunny South Carolina. From Toronto, Canada, a shout out to Marianne and Felix for submitting this photo of a family celebration with 3 of their 4 grandchildren. Anne Marie's prayers were answered after her twin granddaughters were born safely, despite their mother's high-risk pregnancy. The girls were in the neonatal unit for several months, but are thriving now, praise the Lord. Thanks to Yvonne and Francis in Mumbai, India for submitting their photo with 4 of their 5 grandchildren. They tell us the Bombay Archdiocese Senior Citizens Association conducted a series of events for the last 4 Sundays, all in anticipation of this special World Day celebration. Oops, a member of our staff couldn't resist sneaking in one of her own. Here's senior producer Holly with granddaughter Julia, who lives in Anchorage, Alaska. Everyone needs a little green eggs and ham. And while we're at it, I'm sneaking in one too. My parents, Alex and Patty of South Florida, hiking with granddaughter Ima, my beautiful little niece. And last but certainly not least, happy 88th birthday to Joan from Easton, PA. She was so thrilled that the Pope declared her birthday, July 25th, the World Day for Grandparents and the Elderly. Joan is the proud grandmother of 2, and we know she's watching right now. Happy birthday, Joan. And that does it for this edition of EWTN News In Depth. We're so pleased to have had such a great reason to focus this weekend on grandparents and the elderly. We hope you have a chance to reach out this weekend to those special seniors in your life. I'm Montse Alvarado. Join us again next week as we continue to take a deep dive into the issues so important to our Catholic lives. See you then.